Good morning, Temecula Hills. Good morning, church family. Happy Sunday to you all. We are going to start our worship service with some singing and some praise. I invite you to find your seat and stand up. We're going to read from Psalm 139, verse 16. I'll read it for you. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written, every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them. The Lord knew us before we came into existence. He knows us personally, intimately. He knows our heart. So as we come, let us have an open heart towards the will of the Lord, and let's worship together.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Son, not sparing, send him to die. I scarce can take it in that on that cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
When Christ shall come,
when Christ shall come, with shout of acclamation, and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart?
Then I will bow.
Then I will bow in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art.
Before we came to be,
saw the very day we fall away from you. How desperately we need to be redeemed. Lord Jesus, come lead us. We're desperate for your touch. Oh, great and mighty one, with one desire we come, that you would reign, that you would reign in us. We're offering up our lives, a living sacrifice, that you would reign, that you would reign in us. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh again. Come search our hearts and purify our lives. We need your perfect love, we need your discipline. Unless you guide us with your light, Lord Jesus, come lead us. We're desperate for your touch. Oh, great and mighty one, with one desire we come, that you until you return. Oh, great and mighty one, with one desire we come, that you would reign, that you would reign in us. We're offering up our lives, a living sacrifice, that you
morning, church family. I wanted to read a couple verses. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you've done everything, to stand. Stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, and the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for the Lord's people. So I don't know what kind of week everyone had. I don't know what you all went through, but know that we have the Lord, and his word is our sword and our spirit, and he is always with us no matter what we're going through. Might have been a good week, might have been a bad week. I don't know, but he is good. So say good morning to someone. Tell them something good God did in your life this week.
Perfect. Onions, tomatoes, lettuce, barbecue, sauce, A1, cheese, avocados, bacon, chips, cookies, lemonade, and water. And mayo. And pickles. Jeez Louise, if that's not enough for you, then go to a Never Barbecue. No, all kidding aside, I hope we got everything that someone would want on that burger or that hot dog. And we even got some veggie burgers. So listen, if you didn't sign up, that's okay, but on the back of the bulletin, for real, you could really help us out because we shop pretty much for who signed up. On the back of the bulletin, I think it's the third name toward the bottom there, it says Dave Soto or Dave S 7294 Gmail, whatever. If you are gonna go, just email me so I can go get an extra thing of burgers. It's not a big deal because I'd love for you to be there. If you didn't know we were having a barbecue today or you forgot about it or you just figured there'd be extra. There is a little extra, but there's not a lot. And I want to make sure everybody gets a chance to eat. So if you're not signed up, just email me right now or right during this, not when Jeff's preaching, but or when Addison's singing. But either right now or afterwards, because I want to make sure you guys have enough to eat. There's no coffee, no donuts, because as soon as this sermon's over, we want to just head out those doors and spend some time. So
you don't want you to fill up on donuts.
That's right. No filling up on donuts. So bring some frisbees, a basketball, gloves and ball for some kids. There's two play areas for the kids, a big wide open area at Crown Hills. So love to see you there. Again, if you forgot to sign up or didn't have a chance, just email me so I know to go get some extra burgers for you. Cool? All right. Marriage Monthly tune-up. And if you want to be in the cornhole competition, then Tom Ronis is in the back there. So as soon as you get there, get with Tom, and he will get you guys signed up for that tournament there. Monthly marriage tune-up that is coming up here on May 19th on Friday from 6 to 8:30. I know we have some regular tenders that go to that, but if you've never been to one before, that doesn't mean you can't just come in at any time and join that. Dave Hendricks is here this morning, so if you have any questions about that, you can get with Dave. His wife, Vicky, helped facilitate that along with Susan and
Chris
Pruitt, and they're just not here today, but Dave is, so good to see you, sir. All right.
And then our next announcement is the women's retreat. That's going to be Saturday, May 20th from 9:30 to 2:30. And our study is going to be on the joy of serving, and it's going to be here at the church. And the cost is $30. Breakfast and lunch is served. If you went to the last one, the food was amazing. So you should come again. And it was a wonderful time to get to fellowship with the ladies in our church. There's a QR code in your bulletin that you can scan, or you can talk to Marianne. I know she would love to talk to you about it. And then, gentlemen, we also have another serving opportunity for you to come and help us with the women's retreat. Just so that the ladies can have a wonderful time not having to serve, and they can just learn about the Lord and His Word and fellowship with one another. If you have any questions about that or you want to sign up, you can talk to Eric Richardson, who was over there. I don't know where he's back there now. And he'll give you all the information on that.
And Eric's cooking for us today, too. So thank you,
yes,
Eric, for doing that.
Thank
Appreciate
you.
That. All right, we're going to take our offering. If you're a guest with us, again, this is for our regular tenders. This is not for you. We just are glad you're here. But if you'd like to drop anything on this contact card, if we can meet a practical need and answer a question about our church, pray for you, we have contacts card in there, and you can drop it into the bulletin, in the basket or on the back there as well. As our society becomes more hostile to our Savior, I was reminded that we should continue to be closer to that Savior and to those that he calls his own. So I just pray today that if you are not signed up for that picnic, that you come, because it is great to fellowship with his people and to communicate his love to each other. Mm-hmm. So I hope you do that. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you so much that you are here even now, and that you are in control of all things, and you love us as we are your children. we are heirs to that kingdom, Lord, and that is a wonderful thing, and what a reminder to have. I pray, Lord, today that whatever thoughts, that they be focused on you, whatever problems we have, that we set them in front of your feet, Lord, and we allow you to deal with them the way you would want us to. Lord, I pray that we are patient with each other. We are patient with those in our family. We are patient with those that are coworkers that do not know you, to point them to you, Lord. We thank you again for that precious name of Jesus, who died and who was raised and who is coming back for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's all stand together.
Come out of sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, oh sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can tear. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your faith. A wanderer, come home. You're not too far. Lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, to come as you are. There's hope for the hopeless and all those who've strayed. Come sit at the table, come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary, rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't cure. So lay down your So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, to come as you are, come as you are, fall into his arms, to come as you are. Joy for the morning, oh sinner, be still. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burden. Lay down your shame.
to sing a new song this morning. It's called Christ Be Magnified. If you know it, please sing along. And if you don't, give it your best try. But also, more importantly, let's reflect on the words as we're singing.
The creation suddenly articulate with a thousand tongues to lift one cry. Then from north to south and east to west, we'd hear Christ be magnified. Where the whole earth echoing his eminence, his name would burst from sea and sky, from rivers to the mountain tops, we'd hear Christ be magnified. And oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. And oh, Christ be magnified, the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. When every creature finds its inmost melody, and every human heart its native cry, oh, then in one enraptured hymn of praise, we'll sing Christ be magnified. And no, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. And oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. And I won't bow to idols, I will stand and worship you. And if it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice because you're there too. And I won't be formed by feelings, I hold fast to what is true. And if the cross brings transformation, then I'll be crucified with you. Because death is just the doorway into resurrection life. And if I join you in your sufferings, then I'll join you when you rise. And when you return in glory with the angels and the saints, my heart will still be singing, and my song will be the same. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. And oh, Christ be magnified, the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. And oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. And oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me.
Let's all remain standing for the reading of his word.
We're going to be in the book of Romans for our reading this morning. We'll be reading the last part of chapter 11 and then moving into verse 12. Romans 11, verse 33. Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and how inscrutable his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord? Or who has been his counselor? Or who has given a gift to him that he might be repaid? For from him, and through him, and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercy of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by the testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Father, I thank you for giving us this passage and the scriptures which follow that show us that it's not just simply theology, Lord. It's a body. It's a group of people living and working together that form the church. It is the gifts that you have presented to us, and I thank you. I thank you for the gift that you have given Brother Jeff, and I just ask that this morning that gifting might just hit our hearts and that we might understand that you have gifted us all to do something in your body. I thank you so much, Lord, for this, the prophetic part of your word, which doesn't just teach us and give us information, but which exhorts us to work and follow after you. Thank you, Jesus, for what you're going to do. And I just thank you for the work that Jeff has put into hearing from you, listening to you, praying to you, and studying what your word has to say. And help each of us to know that, Lord, we are a part of a very special organism called your body. It's in the name of Jesus Christ, to the head of that body, we pray. Amen.
Well, thank you, Bruce. I always appreciate your reading and prayer. It's good to be here this morning. Good morning, church. I had a rough week with a viral infection, and then yesterday woke up with these massive lips that if you would have saw me last night when I went to bed, looked kind of comical. I have a condition called angioedema, and I was worried it'd be a distraction, and I wouldn't be able to speak. But by the grace of God, I'm much better. So thank you for that. We don't know. Yeah, we don't know what causes it. We're working on that. But I was thinking, you know, a lot of people pay money to have their lips injected, and I got it for free. So. But I hope that won't be a distraction and that my lips won't be a distraction, but we can focus on what words God has for my lips today. So thank you for that. Years ago, Shelley and I were traveling with our kids, and we stopped at a KOA campground in northeastern Utah, right across from this big lake called Bear Lake. And we pulled in on a Saturday. We're just going to be there for the night. And we noticed there was a sign out front that there would be a church service the next morning in the recreational hall of this KOA campground. So we said, hey, that'd be fun to go to. So we woke up the next morning. We went. And we enjoyed some amazing fellowship with some believers there. Had God-honoring worship. Had solid teaching of the word. And it was a real encouraging time together. I think our two families over doubled the size of that congregation that Sunday. And what we found out is the pastor and his wife had moved from Texas to do a church plant in that county of Utah, and they were the only Christian church in that county, and which was kind of stunning. And over the years, I when the Lord would prompt me, I would sometimes think about them and pray for that church. And I don't know whatever happened to them. But in preparation, I did look online, and there is one Baptist church in that county. So the presence of God and his church is still there. But what it brought to mind for me was just how marvelous the church is, the body of Christ. And I've traveled in different countries and different situations, and it's so cool to gather with believers, worship the same God for the same purpose of strengthening one another for the glory of him and to build his kingdom. And that is something that in this passage today, Paul will help us understand in part how that happens and how he has gifted us, that the Holy Spirit has gifted us for the purpose of strengthening and building the church. If I were to ask you this morning how you view the church, would you say it's more of an organization or an organism? How would you think about that? You'll see that the title to this message is The Organism. And I would look today, as we look at the passage of Scripture and understand what the Bible teaches about the church, I would contend that the church is more than more like a living organism than it is an organization. And how we view this church, the church in this regard, might be revealed sometimes in how we talk about church. We often ask, probably most commonly, where do you go to church? That's probably a common question we've asked and we've heard asked, which almost makes us feel like it's an organization. We go to a place, it's somehow separate from us, and it's something we do. Although maybe a little clunkier, maybe not as smooth, but maybe we should be asking something like, well, what body do you fellowship with? Who are you fellow members of in the body of Christ? For those of you who consider this your church home, how do you view Temecula Hills? More as an organization or more as a living organism, part of the body of Christ? Are we just a church or are we a vibrant spiritual community really seeking to live out our purpose, bringing glory to God by making maturing disciples of Jesus? Is that really how we see ourselves? In their book, The Trellis and the Vine, Colin Marshall and Tony Payne talk about refocusing church ministry on disciple-making. Rather than just maintaining church programs and structures, the authors use the metaphor of a trellis and a vine to illustrate the difference between the structures of the church, the organization, and the organism. The trellis is the organization, necessary and important to support the work of the church, but is not the primary focus of the church. The primary focus of the church is disciple making. Each one of us working together to encourage one another to bear fruit. And the church is how God uses his people to bear fruit. We need the organization, but ultimately it's about producing maturing disciples in Jesus. And I think we also need to remind ourselves who builds the church and based on what. Let's look at Matthew 16, 13 through 18. A lot of these scriptures will be up on the screens. You don't have to look at them. But if you do want a Bible, there is one in front of you underneath the seats if you want to grab that. But in Matthew 16, there's an account where Peter confesses Jesus as the Christ. Now, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter replied, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail." The church is built by the Lord based on the confession that he is Lord. This rock that Jesus is referring to is that confession that in fact Jesus is Messiah. He is the anointed one. He is the Christ. And notice it says, "I will build my church," not, "Now you go build my church." And as Jesus builds his church, his followers who have made this same confession, all of us, revealed to us by God, are called as we mature to be conformed into the likeness of Jesus. Romans 8:29, for those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And see, by the grace of God, we are all gifted by the Holy Spirit to accomplish this purpose through the church. 1 Corinthians 12:11 says this, all these are empowered by one and the same Spirit, who apportions to each one individually as he wills. The Lord builds his church by the confession of his lordship by his people, and also by how he has gifted people, and he has prepared things for us to do. Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. The church is the gathering of believers, and believers are called to be in community with one another, living the Spirit-filled life together. So today, we're not just talking about spiritual gifts, but the context, the place where those gifts are to be used, the church. Do we look at church based on what it is doing and what it is doing for us, or what we are doing for her? President John F. Kennedy is famous. One of his most famous quotes is, ask not what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country. Well, sorry, Mr. President, you're not the first one to come up with this idea. This is the message that Paul's trying to communicate to us. We shouldn't be asking what the church can do for us, but rather what can we do for the church? How do we see ourselves in the big picture? Are we right in the middle of everything and everything's supposed to revolve around us? Or are you looking towards the center of the church, the focal point of the church, which is Jesus, and seeing how you can direct your attention in that direction and along the way help your fellow believers do the same? That is the heart of discipleship, of us being transformed into the likeness of Christ with each other's help and all by the grace of God. We are not called to be disciples of one another or of a pastor or of church leaders or even of one of the apostles or disciples in the New Testament. We are called to be disciples of Jesus and him alone. And do we see heaven all about our reward? And that it's about us, and we look forward to that day where there will be no suffering, which is a good thing to look forward to. Well, that's all about us making us more comfortable. Or do we see it as it's described in the Revelation, where the bride of Christ, the church, gathers for the wedding feast, and we glorify God forever? Is that how we see ourselves? So we should view this passage that we're going to look at today with the right mindset that we spoke of last week, as living sacrifices, surrendered, remembering always that we have been brought into this community of believers, the church, all by the design, calling, and grace of God, made possible only by the shed blood and battered body of Jesus, who, victorious over death by his resurrection, ascended to his proper place at the right hand of the Father, preparing a place for us. So what is the starting point, according to Paul? We need to look at our own mindset and rightly see our individual positions within the big picture. Point one on your outline, if you're taking notes, the Lord builds his church by encouraging the humility and right mindset of his people. Let's look at verse 3, how Paul starts this particular section of Scripture. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. So Paul starts in verse 3 with a word for, which is an indication that he's continuing his line of reasoning and his line of thought is continuing when he uses this word. And it flows from the previous verses. I believe going all the way back to the end of Romans 11 that Bruce read for us in verse 36, for from him and through him and to him are all things, to him be glory forever. Amen. And then the flow of the argument continues through Romans 12, 1 and 2. Nathaniel described a couple weeks ago about the surrendered life that we are called to lead because of the mercies of God and what he's given us. Last week, we learned a new word by Brian, who's not here for me to poke fun at a little bit, but this word, theopracticology, completely made up, and I guess it's okay. I couldn't think of a better word. But the idea is, with this foundation theology that we learned so richly about in the first 11 verses or 11 chapters of Romans, and how we are saved by faith alone, what does that look like in the Christian's life? It's almost like two sides of a coin. If one side we understand the proper truth of salvation, what flows from that is a redeemed life. What flows from that naturally is a life in the Spirit building the kingdom. Paul here wants us to recognize that this progression of character, when he is developing what's important in Christian character and for our surrender and our seeing how we can be used, flows from that idea of a transformed life. That's fundamental to his argument. And that this transformation of character is fundamentally seen in our relationships with one another. Well, let's read our whole passage today that we're looking at. We're starting looking at Romans 12, 3 through 8, but I want to start back at the beginning of chapter 12 so we can read it in context. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members of one of another. Having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, let us use them. If prophecy in proportion to our faith, if service in our serving, the one who teaches in his teaching, the one who exhorts in his exhortations, the one who contributes in generosity, the one who leads with zeal, and the one who does acts of mercy with cheerfulness. You know, too often I think sometimes we recognize that we are saved by grace, but somehow the rest is up to us. Our sanctification, the building of the church, it's all put on our shoulders for us to do. Instead, I think we should view the sufficiency of God's grace for salvation is the same grace that enables us and empowers us to be faithful followers of him. In reality, the work is being done through us, not so much by us. And Paul is moving from an individual assessment, looking at ourselves, into more of a corporate and collective mindset as we look at this. So let's look how Paul, let's break this down in verse 3 and see how he continues. He starts out with, "For by the grace given to me." He is not calling on his apostolic authority here, interestingly. He's starting from a point of recognizing the grace that's been extended to him, that same grace that is common to all believers. The same grace that was given freely to Paul, he's making us remember we have the same grace. We have been called into the same fellowship because of God's grace. In one sense, he's putting himself on the same ground as all fellow believers and saying, "I received this grace. I want you to understand the same grace." And he goes on to say, "I say to everyone among you." So this is more of a firm but not stern admonition to the church. It's kind of hard when you're trying to encourage people to be humble to sound prideful, and Paul is exhibiting humility here. He is addressing everyone in the church, and what he has to say applies to all believers in the church. He goes on to say, I say to everyone among you not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think. in order to properly understand how our giftedness can serve the church, we need to start with humility, as Paul has just exemplified himself. Paul is demonstrating the very humility he is asking the whole church to assume. When he goes on to use the word think, he's referring actually to a way of thinking, or maybe even a goal of thinking, not to just thinking itself. It's similar to the renewing of the mind that we see in Philippians 2. And this is the perfect example of humility by Christ. Philippians 2, 1 through 5. So if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you not only look to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among you yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus. Not something we can come up on by ourselves, something we have in Christ Jesus. And when we talk about humility, I think sometimes we shouldn't confuse humility maybe with feelings of inadequacy. Maybe we don't think we can contribute to the church in some way, that we're not really gifted. And sometimes that can appear to be humility, but sometimes it just may be not properly informed or not really understanding giftedness, or maybe even disobedience or laziness, thinking, well, I can't do anything, so I'm not going to do anything. I don't think that's the type of humility Paul's talking about. Whichever the case is here, what we shouldn't do is be driven to complacency because we don't understand our giftedness and humility. Or maybe you worry that you may be too prideful or appear too prideful if you openly express your gifts in the church. Well, there can be pride in that, I think. But when God has gifted us by his grace and we use that in the right way to build up the church, it's not boasting to give him the credit for what he's doing through us. When someone says, hey, I appreciate you, job well done, it is okay to say, all by the grace of God. That's accurate and humble, I believe. 2 Corinthians 10:13 says, but we will not boast beyond limits, but will boast only with regard to the area of influence God assigned to us, to reach even to you. Boast only in Christ, because only he has made it possible for us to do anything. So this mindset is referred to as sober judgment. We see that at the end of verse 3. But to think with sober judgment. Do not think more highly than we ought, and to think with sober judgment. So what does that mean? It is this right mindset. It's an understanding of what we have been talking about, that our salvation by God's grace, our surrender to him, is by his grace that will help us look at ourselves in a right-minded way. A forward-looking and continuous idea, not a one-time thing, not an intellectual process, but thinking in the right direction of Jesus, proper, sober-minded, and a right assessment of ourselves that we are sinners saved by grace. It will help us rightly assess how he has gifted us and rightly understand how we should exercise those gifts in the body. And so how do we do this? Or what is the caveat that Paul continues? He says, by the measure of faith assigned, which can be a little confusing. That's at the end of verse 3. And it's not really well understood exactly what this means, but most scholars and commentators would agree it doesn't mean a saving faith. It doesn't make sense to think that somehow our faith varies for that faith that we exhibit with salvation. We're not slightly born again and then fully born again. We're not slightly regenerate or fully regenerate. There is no varying degree of faith there. There's a minimum faith that we have when we come to faith in Jesus, and that's probably not what Paul is talking here. There aren't different degrees of salvation. So there's two options to consider this by the measure of faith assigned. One is that faith here is referring to not to differing gifts necessarily, but differing capacities for God's people to be in service in the church. That's one view. Maybe he does equip people with varying degrees of faith in their maturity and stronger faith and weaker faith to work in the church. And I suppose that's a possibility, but I would probably lean a little bit more to the second opinion is that this measure of faith is something that we all possess and is the standard or metric we are to measure everything by. By all of us using the same standard, then we could have a humble and sober assessment of ourselves in relationship to others. We all started in the same place, did not deserve salvation, and yet by God's grace, it was extended to us. And we are all called to the same body by this same faith. And this should cause us not to think of ourselves more highly than we ought to. But no matter the explanation, our position in the church and our gifting is by the grace of God, and it is to be used for His glory. Hebrews 2, 3 through 4. How shall we escape if we neglect such a great salvation? It was declared at first by the Lord, and it was attested to us by those who heard. While God also bore witness by signs and wonders and various miracles and by gifts of the Holy Spirit, distributed according to His will. So He decides how this gifting is distributed to the church. Now, from a practical standpoint, as we try to assess our own giftedness for the church, I think sometimes we should not decide if we have a gift based on someone else's measure of the gift. We shouldn't base the gift of service based on Dave Soto's standard of service. None of us could keep up with that. And I'm glad he's not here in the room. Or perhaps in our church, Sally Burke's encouragement and exhortation. If I compare myself to her, I definitely do not have the gift of exhortation or encouragement. And I can tell you right now that those two people that I've called out are not comfortable with that because they're humble and they have sober judgment and they have the right mindset because they know anything they have that they are given to the church is completely by the grace of God. So don't compare your giftedness to someone else's giftedness to determine if you have that gift. Because I think sometimes we'll all be discouraged and fall short. But be encouraged that a gift may grow over time as it's used and exercised, which is also another body metaphor. And pray for God to reveal that to you. Well, maybe this is a wake-up call for some of you. If you are prideful and think that somehow your giftedness is more important than someone else's, or you look at others and say, I wish they were more gifted. But the right mindset is to consider the source of your gift and who you're being called to serve and how you are called to serve others through that giftedness with humility and sober judgment. Or perhaps you've been using false humility or feelings of inadequacy as an excuse not to use your giftedness for the body. And this has challenged you to identify your giftedness and be obedient with what God has given you. There are many practical ways to do this, and next week, we're having a sermon specifically talking more about spiritual gifts, and we'll look forward to that, and there'll be some practical ways that we can learn more how we can do that. But this week, we should all pray for God to reveal to us where we need to repent of pride and how we can examine ourselves with sober judgment and assessment of how we're gifted and how we can serve the church. So how does this humility and right mindset help me understand the church and my role in the church? Well, Paul addresses this by using the metaphor of the human body as an explanation of the church and how it is tied to our connection in Christ. We move from our own attitudes to an idea of what is required for community. We go from the self-assessment to the assessment of our community, our church. Point two, the Lord builds His church by encouraging the unity and diversity of His people. Verse 4 and 5, for as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function. So we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members one of another. So why the body reference? There are multiple theories of where Paul gets this idea, and one commentator I read had at least 8 different options. We won't be going into all those. But as a physician, I always kind of was curious, how would the first century person view the human body? And what the state of the art in medicine was in the Greek world was that the human body was composed of 4 humors: blood, yellow bile, black bile, and phlegm. And that these corresponded to the 4 elements, which were air, fire, earth, and water. Now, we do have a different understanding of the human body today, but one thing that the ancient Greeks recognized is the body did have this complete interconnection and interdependence of all parts of the body. They had a very deep understanding of that, and I think that's why this metaphor of Paul is so powerful, because they saw that disease and death was because that balance was out of whack. It wasn't in a good balance, and that this proper balance was important for health, and disruption of this balance was the cause of disease and death. It kind of sounds like a good application for the church. Verse 4, for as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function. This is one of the reasons the body is a good metaphor for the church, because each part isn't reduced to just what its function is for, but is important because it's connected to the rest of the body. Interconnectedness, interdependence. Now, the diversity Paul's talking about is not diversity of identity, it's diversity of function and giftedness. Our culture so often wants to have diversity of identity. That's the most important thing. In the church, we all have only one identity, the body of Christ. Our identity is in Him, and that's not the diversity Paul is talking about. He's talking about the diversity of the giftedness of His people and how they're created and called to serve the church. If the creator of the universe and the person of the Holy Spirit calls you and gifts you for a specific purpose, no matter how small that may seem to you, you can be assured that it is important and it is vital to the body. There's another reality we see in Scripture, and it is clear that we are called to be in community with one another, to serve one another, all for the glory of God. Look at Hebrews 10. Verse 23, let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. The unity and the holiness of the church is central to the gospel as described by Paul. It is vital understanding to the whole gospel message. The church is not just a side note. Verse 5 of Romans 12. So we, though many, are one body in Christ and individually members one of another. There is no unity without community. The most prominent passage to discuss spiritual gifting that uses this image of the body is probably in 1 Corinthians 12. We'll look at verses 12 and 13. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in one spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and all were made to drink of one spirit. But you see, the use of the term body here is not, I think, just a metaphor or an analogy, but he is using this to describe a real connectedness that we have with Christ, in Christ, as the church. As believers, we already share in this community by our identity in Christ. And this is not for our own edification, for the sake of ourselves, but for the edification of the entire body for the building of His church. Ephesians 4, 11 through 13. And He gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. In verse 5, He says, members of one another. And this has just stuck out to me, and I've been just meditating on this week. We don't become a member of a church. We are a member of a church when we come to faith. As believers, we are a member of the church. You, by definition, are a member of other believers. Kind of a crazy concept. In a very supernatural way, we are connected all by the body of Christ. That's why I think sometimes when people hurt in the church, we all hurt. And sometimes when people leave a local church, it hurts sometimes. It stings because people are breaking fellowship. And that can cause all of us to humble. As one part of the body may be in pain, the whole body can feel it. And sometimes if people leave a church maybe for good reasons and they get connected with another church, we should rejoice in that. That should be a good thing. We still are connected within the greater body of Christ. So the question we should ask all of ourselves is, what have I been doing to promote unity in the church? Have I been doing anything that would promote discord? We should pray and repent of any wrong-hearted attitudes of disunity. And if you don't already know how you are gifted, pray for God to show you and search his word and ask others maybe for help to figure that out. Then look forward to using your giftedness for the sake of the body of Christ with a renewed mind and with the idea that it's an act of spiritual worship. We've been talking about giftedness, but let's look in more details of what these gifts are and how that is accomplished. Point three, the Lord builds his church by gifting his people for the growth of the body. Verses 6 through 8 of Romans 12. Having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, let us use them. If prophecy in proportion to our faith, if service in our serving, the one who teaches in his teaching, the one who exhorts in his exhortation, the one who contributes in generosity, the one who leads with zeal, and the one who does acts of mercy with cheerfulness. Well, you'll notice if you have an ESV that this section is subtitled Gifts of Grace. The common vernacular in the church is spiritual gifts, but probably gifts of grace may be a little more accurate. If I could summarize the beginning of verse 6, Paul says, you have spiritual gifts, use them. The church we attended in St. Louis when I was going to school there, once we were studying spiritual gifts, and the pastor had the whole congregation repeat back to him, I am a child of God. I have a spiritual gift. So I thought we might do that right now. No, we're not. At the time, I thought it was very, very awkward, but it stuck with Shelley and I, and we remember that, and it helps us really understand how the church is supposed to function. So Paul here is encouraging that whatever gift you have, use it for the building up, the edification of the church, and ultimately, like we saw at the end of chapter 11, all for the glory of God. You know, I think sometimes when we hear the word gift, we might go to the idea of human gifts or presence and think about that metaphor or that analogy. And I still think gift is the best word in the English language to translate what Paul is translated from Paul's writing here, rather. You know, we were just at Legoland with our twin grandsons for their birthday, and we bought them some gifts. They wanted some things, and we gave them to them, and the expectation is they're going to do whatever they want with them. We don't give them these gifts with any expectation that they're going to keep them or cherish them or not give them away or destroy them or lose them. You just never know with six-year-olds what might happen. So we don't have those expectations because human gifts really, in that setting, should be no strings attached. Here you go. Here's a gift. But grace gifts are somewhat different because the giver of the grace gifts, the spiritual gifts, does have strings attached. The purpose of the gift is for us to use them for him. Now, if I were to give my wife a massage table for her birthday, it's your gift, honey, but I want you to give me massages. Somehow, that's probably not in the nature of human giftedness, it's of giving no strings attached gifts. But God's idea of gifting with these grace gifts or spiritual gifts is he does want us to use them for him. And that's how they get expressed. And that's how we glorify him, by using his giftedness that he's given us for him. It's for the benefit of the church and for his bride. And ultimately, in the end, for his glory. So the word that gets transmitted gift here, I geeked out on the etymology of words. And the word that gets transmitted gift actually has a much deeper meaning that originally came into the English language many years ago with a particular meaning. And that word, when I tell it to you, is going to mean something different to you because we've lost that original meaning of the word that came from the Greek, entered the English language, and used was very specifically what Paul's talking about here. And like I said, the word gift that the ESV translator used is the best one we have. I don't disagree with that. But what is this Greek word that entered the English language that was used for the church? It's charisma. The plural would be charismata in the Greek, or charismas, as we might say in English. So it entered the English language, And you can see, if you look up online, one of the definitions of charisma is spiritual gifts for the church. Merriam-Webster elaborates this etymology of the word. The Greek word charisma means favor or gift. It comes from the verb charizetsai, to favor, which in turn comes from the noun charis, meaning grace. In English, charisma was originally used in Christian context to refer to a gift or power bestowed upon an individual by the Holy Spirit for the good of the church, a sense that is now very rare. And that's Merriam-Webster's words, not mine. So we as believers all have charismas, if you will, or grace gifts, or we can use the popular phrase spiritual gifts, as we often do, just to avoid confusion. So let's look at the gifts Paul lists with the exhortations with each. And these gifts, these seven gifts that he mentions in these verses, can be broken down actually into two categories. And there are two categories of either speaking or proclaiming or service. So if we look at it, speaking gifts are prophecy, teaching, exhortation. Serving gifts are service, giving, leadership, and acts of mercy. Leadership may sound a little funny, but leadership is a form of service to the body. No one's worth their leadership ability if they're not a servant leader. And the ultimate servant leader that we were given example of was Jesus. 1 Peter 4, 10 through 11, Peter gives a very succinct summary of spiritual gifts. As each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. Whoever speaks as one who speaks, oracles of God, whoever serves as one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. To him belong glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. So these gifts are central to the body, are gifts of expression, of truth, and of service. So let's break them down a little bit, and we're going to dig into more of these next week. But prophecy, notice how Paul follows each one of these with some kind of admonition. So with prophecy in proportion to our faith. And there's a lot of distinctions and differences between Old Testament view of prophecy and then a New Testament view of prophecy. And we won't get into all that this morning. But prophecy, by definition, is some type of revelation given to somebody by God. And it would be very important, you notice, proportion to our faith. Somebody with either a weaker or younger faith needs to be very careful if they feel they're given a prophecy by God, something they should share, because they may not have the discernment and the maturity to understand the significance of that. Likewise, a mature person may have better understanding and be more confident it's a truth from God. And that can make us a little leery, because people might say, I have something to say from God as a revelation. But the reality is there is a lot in Scripture to tell us how to test that. 1 Thessalonians 5:19 through 22. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not despise prophecies, but test everything. Hold fast to what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. So this prophecy is mostly about declaring truths from God. And there are checks and balances. It's not foretelling the future so much that we think of prophecy, so much as declaring the truths of God as revealed by him, proclaiming his goodness, warning of his judgment and wrath, and calling for repentance. Paul goes on to talk about service, and he says, in your serving. The serving itself is glorifying work unto the Lord, so that men may not know. Serving the church, probably primarily serving others in the church and not just serving anyone. This is somebody who just sees something and does it. They just have the knack to serve others. Paul talks about the one who teaches in his teaching. The gift of teaching is a supernatural ability to interpret and communicate and apply God's words. Not necessarily the gift of oration or public speaking, but to be able to teach the word of God faithfully. Paul talks about the one who exhorts in his exhortation. What one is exhorting is important. It must be truthful. Hebrews 10, 24 and 25. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another and all the more as you see the day drawing near. Someone who exhorts is always providing insights and admonitions of God's truth and how they apply to certain situations and people. This does not mean the type of encouragement where you might say, you're special and you're a good person and you do you. It's more the sense of encouraging one in their faith and encouraging them to follow the higher calling of the gospel. He talks about one who contributes in their giving. 2 Corinthians 9:11 through 12. You will be enriched in every way to be generous in every way, which through us will produce thanksgiving to God. For the ministry of this service is not only supplying the needs of the saints, but is also overflowing in many thanksgivings to God. So it's not just being generous in nature, but in giving for the work of the church and of the kingdom, giving to people of the church, giving to build God's kingdom. Besides, that's not really your stuff anyway. God gave it to you in the first place. You're just being obedient to do with it as he's called you to do. He talks about the one who leads with zeal. And leadership here may be talking about leadership in general in the church or specifically to the elders and maybe the deacons of the church. That's a little unclear. But if we look at 1 Thessalonians 5:12 through 13, Paul says this, "We ask you, brothers, to respect those who labor among you and are over you in Lord and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love because of their work. Be at peace among yourselves." Notice that Paul says here with zeal. And this also can be translated diligence or zealous diligence. And I think it's related to the word jealous, this distinction that the God's bride, the church, should be pure and undefiled. And leaders should work to keep that purity so that we do not have any other gods before us. And that's more the description of how God talks about jealousy in the Bible, his holiness, his purity. And leaders should protect the church in that zeal. He goes on to say, the one who does acts of mercy with cheerfulness. The only place Paul uses show mercy for humans is in this passage. And notice it says here, the one who does acts of mercy. Not just somebody who's compassionate and feels merciful, but actually to take that to action and do something with it. 2 Corinthians 9:7, each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Cheerful acts of mercy. Probably he is referring to those showing mercy to others within the church and primarily doing things like visiting the sick, caring for the elderly or disabled, and providing for the poor of the church. So we can see here that we all have gifting, and my encouragement to you is find it and use it. If you're not sure what yours is, then pray. Read Romans 12 again, 1 Corinthians 12, Ephesians 4, and come back next week. It is a joyous and worshipful thing to have been given gifts from God and to use them for the building of his church, for the growing of his kingdom, all for his glory. If you think that you don't, then maybe we need to relook at things and humble ourselves. Well, I hope this passage today and our discussion has helped you to see the church more as a living organism and not just an organization, and that we together can bring glory to God by using our giftedness. We've seen that the Lord builds his church by encouraging the humility and right mindset of his people, by growing the unity and diversity of his people, and by gifting it as people for the growth of the body. I hope this has caused you to marvel at the church and how God chooses to build the church. I hope that as we continue to study this, you'll be encouraged and seek ways that you can serve one another in the body. So you may be asking, if you're not a believer, well, how do I become part of this organism, the church? Well, that is done by faith. This living organism is made possible because of the giver of life, the only one who can raise the dead to life, the only true living one. Turn to him. Admit that you are dead in your current existence and repent of your sin, and he will be faithful and just to forgive you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just praise you for you and who you are and for your glory, Lord, and I thank you for the church. I thank you for how you have started the church, how you built the church, how you grow the church today, Lord. And may we, as part of this church, be faithful followers of you to use our giftedness to give you all the glory, Lord. And I pray for our time together at the picnic, Lord. May we have a sweet time of fellowship where we can encourage one another in our faith. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's all stand and close together one last song of worship.
Precious cornerstone, sure foundation, you are faithful to the end. We are waiting on you, Jesus. We believe you're all to us. Precious cornerstone, sure foundation, you are faithful to the end. We are waiting on you, Jesus. We believe you're all to us. Let the glory of your name be the passion of the church. Let the righteousness of God be the holy flame that burns. Let the saving love of Christ be the measure of our lives. We believe you're all to us. Only Son of God, sent from heaven, hope and mercy at the cross. You are everything, you're the promise, Jesus. You are all to us. Let the glory of your name be the passion of the church. The righteousness of God be a holy flame that burns. Let the saving love of Christ be the measure of our lives. We believe you're all to us. You're all to of our lives.
I love that line, may the saving love of Christ be the measure of all our lives. What a beautiful thing. If you would like prayer, we're gathering over here. A group of people will be there that could pray with you. We would encourage as many people as possible to join us at our picnic. And I have an assignment for you, something to apply. What we learned is maybe have intentional conversations about church, about fellowship with one another. And that could be uncomfortable for some people, but maybe being intentional about that could maybe help all of us help each other grow in Christ. Have a great day. God bless you.